I'm Joshua Bardwell, and you're going to learn something today. Failsafe may be the most important setting that you set on your quadcopter. If you don't set the failsafe setting right, then anytime your RF link drops or your receiver browns out or disconnects or anytime anything goes wrong, your quadcopter will, who knows what it'll do. In a lot of cases, as we're about to learn, because Christmas is near, and Christmas is known internationally as the Day of Lost Quadcopters, in many cases the quadcopter will just fly away into the distance till Never Never Land, where it will join all the other quadcopters that got lost on Christmas Day with Peter Pan fighting the pirates. No, it'll fall on somebody's house or their head, or as soon as the battery runs out, you dopes. So set your failsafe correctly. But today we're going to talk about a time when it doesn't actually matter how you set your failsafe. Sort of. Half clickbait, half true. On a multi-rotor, there's two places to set failsafe correctly. One is in the flight controller, and that's where you control what the flight controller will do when it detects that a failsafe event has occurred. We're going to take a look at that in a second. The other place to set failsafe is in the receiver, which is how the receiver changes its behavior when it detects that a failsafe has occurred. And if we look right here in OpenTX at the model setup screen, right here where you bind the receiver, if you've got a D16 protocol receiver, you actually set the failsafe behavior right here in the radio. That's one reason why I think D16 receivers are fantastic. You don't have to go fiddling around with a failsafe button on the receiver to make sure that failsafe is set correctly. And the options that we've got here are no pulses, and no pulses is commonly described as when failsafe happens, the receiver shuts down and stops outputting pulses, stops outputting signal to the flight controller. Although, as we'll see in a minute, that's actually not true. And that's part of the surprise of this video for some of you. Other options include receiver, which basically means that, hey, you want to do it the old-fashioned way by pushing the failsafe button on the receiver? Go for it. Well, just whatever the receiver's got programmed into it is what we'll do. We won't override that with this setting. Custom lets you choose fixed channel positions for failsafe. You would typically use that with a fixed wing plane. A common thing to do is to kind of set the plane with just a little bit of left rudder and just a little bit of elevator and aileron so that it kind of slowly spirals into the ground. I don't really fly fixed wings, I've just heard that. So fixed positions, we wouldn't really use that for a multi-rotor. And hold last position. And hold position we typically don't want for a multi-rotor, because we hold position, we're probably just gonna, I don't know why you would want that for a plane. But anyway, those are your options. Now, here's the part where I'm gonna blow some of your freaking minds. Here it is, failsafe is set to hold, and here's my quad, which I have bound. And by the way, I'm never actually sure if this setting takes place at binding time, or if you change the setting, does it happen like instantaneously every time you power up? So just to be sure, I rebound this receiver with hold as the setting. Now, check this out. We're gonna arm. But no, really, we're gonna arm. There we go. And what do you think's gonna happen when I turn this off? It's set to hold, right? So a lot of you think that the receiver is going to continue outputting pulses to the flight controller. The flight controller will not know that a failsafe has happened, and the quadcopter will fly away to Never Never Land to be with the other lost quadcopters of Christmas Day. Let's see if you're right. Failsafe, what? How did the flight controller know that failsafe had occurred if the receiver was holding pulses?
PronounceNames.com.
Now I have to give credit at this point to another YouTuber.
Hi, my name is Paweł Spychalski.
And I'm going to link to his video down in the video description, as you know, he should get credit for pointing this out.
Today we're going to take a short course how to correctly, and by mean correctly, I mean really in a proper way, set up a failsafe.
Because Betaflight doesn't actually care about no pulses when it is using a serial protocol like SBUS or FPORT. Those protocols, how dumb, we're not gonna rely on the presence or absence of pulses. There are no pulses. It's ones and zeros. It's a digital serial protocol. And in that digital serial protocol, there is a bit, which is the failsafe bit. And it's just used by the receiver to indicate to the flight controller whether a failsafe is occurring. And it turns out that when the receiver sets that bit, it doesn't matter if the receiver is holding last value or no pulses. There's never any no pulses. There's just the failsafe bit gets set and the flight controller goes into failsafe. So then the argument, and this is the argument that Pavel makes, the argument is that you don't need to set no pulses. You may as well set hold position, or it doesn't even matter what you set. And that's where I disagree, because as interesting as this technical curiosity is, practically speaking, I always advise people to set no pulses. And the reason I do that is because some of you guys are not using SBUS or a serial protocol. It's more and more rare, I do admit. But some people out there are still using PWM or CPPM receivers, and there are also some firmwares out there that don't pay attention to that bit the same way that Betaflight does. So, because there's uncertainty about this, I still always recommend that you set your receiver failsafe to no pulses. And the reason is that there's no downside. There's literally no downside that I'm aware of to setting it no pulses. The behavior doesn't change at all. So you can get away with setting your failsafe to hold position, but what's the point? If I gave the advice of saying, hey, if you're using SBUS or any other serial protocol, you can set it to hold, you would not get any benefit, and some of you out there would miss that distinction, and you would set it, and you would lose your quad. So I still recommend you set it to no pulses. Let's go back over to the desk, and let's just take a quick look at how I set up my Betaflight flight controller failsafe settings, as long as we're talking about this topic. Here we are in the Betaflight Failsafe tab, and if you don't see the Failsafe tab here on the left side, it's probably because you haven't enabled Expert Mode. Go ahead and enable Expert Mode, and in fact, what I like to do is just click this little gear icon here and say permanently enable Expert Mode. Yes, thank you so much. I'd like to see all these extra options. And what I like to do for my Failsafe settings is, number one, for the four main channels, you have the option of Auto, which for pitch, roll, and yaw means that they are centered. And for the throttle, auto means to go to idle, to basically lower the throttle all the way down. Now, the default behavior is to set all of those to auto. So the quad will center the sticks. If you're in auto level mode, that means it'll level out. If you're in acro mode, it means it will simply hold its last position. In other words, if you were upside down, it'll stay upside down, but it won't keep spinning. If you're in the middle of a roll, it'll stop rolling and freeze. And that, but for throttle, I prefer to leave throttle to hold. And the reason is that if you're ever in a scenario where you get like a micro fail safe, but then recover, I'd rather the throttle hold during that brief interval than suddenly drop to zero and sort of unsettle and disturb the quad. You might think it's dangerous to have the throttle set to hold in a failsafe condition, but remember, these settings here are only for what's called stage one failsafe. During stage one failsafe, the quadcopter is sort of hoping that the signal will come back. We'll give it just a brief window to see if the signal comes back before we just take the ultimate nuclear option. And how long will it stay in stage one failsafe is controlled by this setting. So the default is 5, which is 0.5 or half second. The quadcopter will stay in stage one failsafe for a half second, then it'll enter stage two failsafe, during which it will, well, I believe the best behavior is to drop. You can try to do what's called landing, but landing is really a misnomer. In landing, it goes into auto level mode and it chooses a fixed throttle value that you hope will bring it gently to a landing, but in reality, it has no way of knowing its altitude. It has no way of knowing if it's actually descending or climbing, and I just don't recommend that anyone use the landing option. Stage 2 failsafe should always be set to drop. The one exception to this is if you are playing with GPS rescue mode and you have thoroughly tested it, you might consider using GPS rescue as your stage 2 failsafe. However, that can only be done from the command line, and we won't be talking about that any further. You can go watch my video on GPS rescue if you prefer. Link in the video description, as always. I want to point out one more thing, which is that for the aux channels, I have a few of them set to a fixed value instead of hold position. One of those is aux 3, which I use as my RSSI channel. I use AUX3 to hold RSSI. If you watch my video, RSSI in OSD, it describes how to do that. Here in the receiver tab, I've set AUX3 as my RSSI channel, and that's used by my OSD to know what the RSSI value is. The reason I set that to a set value of 1000 is that when I get a micro failsafe, I want to see the RSSI go to zero. I don't want to see the RSSI hold at the last value, you see? So if you're doing RSSI in OSD, pick whatever AUX channel you're using for RSSI and have that failsafe to a set value of 1000 or 0%. The other one is the channel that I use for my arming, and I've got that set to a value of 1700. And the reason for that is it's just a backup that the quad will definitely be disarmed and not in angle mode or beeping or flip crash mode at the time that I go into failsafe. If you are just using a traditional AUX mode to arm and you don't have any other functions there, you don't have to do this, because whenever the quad goes into failsafe, of course it will disarm. But because I have other functions also on this channel, I want to make sure that it doesn't like activate the beeper by accident or something dumb like that. And that's it. That's how you set up failsafe on a quadcopter, and this interesting new nuance about times when the receiver failsafe setting actually doesn't freaking matter. Thanks to you guys for watching. Thanks to Paweł for pointing this out. I apologize for mangling his name throughout this video. I always do my best to pronounce non-English names as close as possible to the right pronunciation. I feel like that's a really respectful thing to do, but unfortunately, sometimes it also means that I'm mangling your name through the whole video. If I just said Paweł, at least I'd sound confident, but I feel like giving it a good try is usually better than nothing. Sorry, Paweł. That's it for this video. Thank you guys so much. Happy flying.